make you laugh. Shows that make you think. Music that moves you. It can only be one place. Universal Broadcasting Network. Tune in at ubnradio.com.
Another one.
Oh, this is sort of slow.
Yeah.
Sort
we
of
the
slow.
Best music.
Yo, he ain't messing with no average chick.
I like that. Ooh, I like this. Thank you. Hey, everybody, welcome to another fun edition of What's Up with Kobylt and Friends. Thank you so much, Kurt, my wonderful Borop, among other things. And every week now we have this thing where he's going to surprise me with the music. So thank you so much.
No problem.
I thought maybe you'd surprise me with Kanye. Am I on? Because I can't hear myself.
Yeah, you're on.
I am? Okay. I thought maybe you'd surprise me with Kanye because he's playing this week at the Forum, and I'm going to go see him. I know. I don't want to hear about it. But, you know, and I tried to get my husband to go. He's like, no way. And I'm like, why not? I said, why don't you ever do that kind of fun stuff with me? He goes, just go with your girlfriend. So I'll let you know how that is by next week. Maybe next week we can do a little Kanye.
Yeah, maybe I can actually do some Kanye.
Find like a really crazy one. Like, is that ridiculous to say? All of his stuff's like
that. Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Okay, well, anyway, thanks for another fun edition. We have another great show coming up for everybody. In studio with me is Jeff Phillips. He is founder of Jeff Phillips Fitness. Some applause for him. We have a large studio audience here today. A lot of people in here.
Hi, Deborah.
But among other things, he's been an actor. You've done so many things, and we will get to that to talk to you about all of that. And thanks for being here today.
Thanks for having me.
I hope getting here wasn't too much. It was pretty easy. There wasn't much traffic today on the 101. That was the good news.
Right. I was no trouble, actually.
Yeah. I mean, some days I just never know if I'm going to make it here on time. And I got here.
I'm a big fan of Waze. Waze.
I know,
is
me
my
too,
friend.
But I have to tell you, Waze is now sending people on ordinary little tiny streets
That's true.
Might have bought your house.
Right.
All of a sudden, it's you know, cars are lined up to the next block. It's a bit of, I'm glad that I live on a street that no one can cut through,
right?
Because they would.
Yeah.
So thank you and welcome. But our first guest, and you can chime in on this as well, is Lynn Lipinski. Lynn, thanks for being with us.
Oh my gosh, that made my heart swell to hear all that applause.
They love you here, Lynn. You are author of a fiction book called Author of God of Internet. Is that it? Wait, God of Internet?
Yeah, God of the Internet.
God of the Internet. Okay. And I want to hear a little bit about that. But you also have done a lot of research on cybersecurity. So that's why we're having you on, especially today. And then we'll talk about your book in a little bit. But what went down this past week? That scared me. In fact, when I saw what happened, and it's a little complicated, so I'll let you explain it. I said, we need to get somebody on the show who can explain in sort of basic terms what's going on out there. So go ahead.
Sure. So if you had trouble, you know, logging into Twitter, Airbnb, or PayPal on Friday morning starting about 7 a.m. Eastern time, the reason why you did is because the server that would direct you to those websites when you type in the name, I won't get into that server bit because it's a little technical, but the server that would direct you to those sites was under what we call a DDoS attack, or a distributed denial of service attack. What this essentially means is that hackers sent a fire hose of traffic to that server. They did it in a really unique way. They actually tapped into and hacked into security cameras, baby monitors, all sorts of devices that talk to the internet that we don't really pay much attention to.
Okay,
and
hang on.
Use those to.
That's the scary part. That they are actually tapping into your baby monitor. And from what I understand, if you've got your laptop open and, you know, you've got a camera on your computer, and everybody does, even if it's off, they can actually turn it on. I used to read about stuff like this. I'm like, nah, that's not true. So that's true? They can actually really infiltrate your home, right?
Yes. Yes.
That's scary.
It is, you know, and we're partly to blame for this. Part of this is that a lot of us leave our passwords on the security cameras or the baby monitors set at ABCDEF or password, and that in fact is how they were able to perpetuate the hack, is just by using all these really unsecure passwords that you know, most of us can't be bothered to change, or we might change it. Like I was for a long time using my dog's name as a password. This is a very weak password, by the way.
What was your dog's name?
Facebook.
What's your dog's name?
Oh, it's Chloe. Yeah. So my password would be I love Chloe, and you could figure that out from my Facebook page probably. Oh, I bet she has her dog's name as her password. So, you know, the onus is on us to do more to secure the systems that we're using, particularly as more and more things get connected to the internet.
Okay, hang on, because I really need to know this. So is it a group of people? Are they computers that are just sort of generating this? How does this happen? A bunch of guys sitting down saying, we're going to screw with the system. I just don't know how it starts. You know what I mean?
Well, so...
Does this scare you?
The National Intelligence Director today is saying that they actually think it's a group of guys, it's hackers who participate in English language hacker forums, which leads you to believe that they might be just United States-based hackers. But on Friday, everybody was thinking this was state-sponsored, that this was the Chinese or the Russians, because the attack was so immense. Nobody'd seen anything like it before. But anyway, today they're saying they think it's just hackers who might have done it to make mischief or to make money.
How do we find these guys, though? And I agree. To me, it sounded something a little bit mischievous. A bunch of guys in their rooms getting together trying to just, you're right, cause havoc, mischief, and just to see how far they can get away with stuff, too, right?
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
Yeah, I mean, the investigation's ongoing. There's a huge amount of data, and we'll see it looked like a really sophisticated site. We'll see if they can trace it back or if maybe people start wanting to brag about it. Nobody's taking credit for it yet, so I know that everybody's watching for that.
Well, we know it's not ISIS because they always take credit for everything, right? So it can't be that. They would have come out and said, it was us, so we know it's not them. But how many either people, computers, or whatever did it affect? Or it didn't? It just affected getting on these sites?
The main effect was that you couldn't log on to the websites. So if you wanted to look at the news headlines on Twitter, you couldn't get to them. So, I mean, it's like a disruption, right? I mean, it's not the end of the world. And if your baby monitor was one of the ones sending all the traffic, you probably wouldn't know. There's really, I doubt you'd even be aware. Even if your computer was infected with the worm, like your laptop, I'm not really sure that most of us would have noticed that our computer was participating in sending a fire hose of traffic to these servers on the East Coast.
So do they get
it happens sneakily.
Right. That server, isn't it? Isn't one of them called DYN? And they're out of like Vermont or something?
Oh, I forget where they are, but yeah, they're called DIN, and they run what are called name servers, which are kind of the backbone of the internet. They're actually the server where when you type in twitter.com, it goes through its ginormous phone book and finds the actual IP address for it and then sends you to that site. So it was a very effective way to cut down a lot of sites on the internet by going to kind of one of the servers holding the phone directory for the internet.
So are these hackers able to get information from us? Are they able to see us? Like, okay, if they went through baby monitors, can they see what's going on in a room?
I don't think that happened on Friday, but I think that is very possible if somebody wanted to target you. I think that they could very easily do that. So change those passwords, you know.
I know, but isn't that a hassle? Because every time, I don't know, one of my accounts gets hacked with something. We all have so many accounts for so many different things.
Right.
If I have to change the name, in fact, my producer and my publicist are like, Deborah, what's your password? We need to get in there and do a little, you know, help with your social media. I'm like, I don't know, because I always have to change it all the time. So I don't know which one I change. It's very hard to keep up with. You know, I guess the deal is change everything if you have to change it once, right?
Right. Well, so, I mean, I keep my passwords in an encrypted file through a program called KeyPass, and this is just some diligence that I picked up when I was doing a lot of research on this. So my passwords tend to be 8 to 16 digits of nonsense, right? You know, I don't use actual words. And, you know, those are more secure. Those are harder to hack. You know, and so I would recommend that people look into those and don't try to have the same password across different programs. And the most important password to protect is your email one, of course, because that would be, if somebody can break into your email, they can basically reset most of your passwords. Because, you know, if you forget your bank password, you say, forgot my password, and it sends you a reset your password link to your email. So email is the one you really need to protect a lot.
That's one reason why I don't keep anything that important in my email. I've got a lot of like school stuff that comes my way, you know, pay your bill for this and that. But somebody wants to go into my email, please don't do that. But if they did, they wouldn't find anything all that interesting, I have to tell you. Okay, so let's take this as an example. What else could these guys do? Could they tap into the water system? I mean, what else are hackers capable of doing? You know, as we go about our lives every day, we don't even think about this. It actually kind of scares me a little.
Well, I have to plug my fiction book a little bit because God.
Oh yeah, we're going
to
get there. Yeah, go ahead.
Was actually written about hacks that I'd heard of that were possible, but that hadn't happened yet, or that had happened in small places. And I wanted to kind of create a worst case scenario for them. But to be honest, you know, your water and power systems are all run on computer controlled systems called SCADA. That's notoriously easy to hack into. Natural gas pipelines are run on these systems. Satellites are, you know, all of these systems are hackable. Anything connected to the internet is hackable. So, you know, one of the inspirations for my fiction writing was the Stuxnet worm. It shut down the uranium enrichment plant in Iran in 2010. And one of the ways that it was able to shut down that plant was that they were able to use just computer code to make the centrifuges, you know, make the pressure in the centrifuges raise so high that it rendered them inoperable. So, I mean, here they are, like computer hackers shutting down an actual plant, you know, on the other side of the world.
So if somebody really wanted to screw with us, I mean, we're always concerned. We're always looking at how to fight a war in one direction. But we really need to be careful, clearly, with people looking to really get us through the underbelly of how we're working, whether it's through our water, our electricity, just to get through our computer systems and screw with everything. How are we preparing for that? I mean, I know the FBI and Homeland Security is on all this stuff, but are they ahead of it or are they just reacting to it?
Well, you know, Department of Homeland Security is pretty much the baseline of internet defense for the United States. But I mean, I think most people would say, honestly, they're playing catch up. You know,
that's the kind of stuff. Can I just say, that's the kind of stuff I want to hear from my presidential candidate. What are we doing to get ahead of this stuff? I mean, everybody's always behind everything. It's like, what are we doing to get five steps ahead? At least two steps? But instead, I always feel like we're playing catch-up to stuff like this or what happened
the
other day.
Well, it's tough to anticipate. That's why. You don't know.
Well, you have to. Right. You know, a good friend of ours, is a game designer. And he very often does work with the government in secret, to be honest, because he has to think of stuff that's going to happen in these games, you know, the kind of games kids play. And they actually hire him to try and figure out what could these guys be thinking. I'm just saying, this is serious stuff. I mean, this time around, perhaps it wasn't. But it could be the next time, you know. So what happens in your book? Do you talk about that kind of thing?
I do. Not in a huge amount of technical detail, but enough to get the flavor of it. In my book, when I wrote the book, we were hearing a lot about ISIS, and they were running a lot of beheading videos. And my fictional mind kept thinking, what if ISIS were hackers? What would they do to create statements? And that's kind of the genesis of the book. So in the book, I have them... they basically get access to the LADWP's SCADA system and are able to kind of mess around with the water treatment system. That's based on something that really did happen earlier this year, where they, you know, hackers were able to access a water system and kind of change how much chlorine was added to the water, rendering it undrinkable. I also have them the hackers are also able to attack into the power grids and also to some extent the banking systems to wipe out some financial account.
Is this a good idea for people to be reading your book or is it going to give people ideas? I mean, I think it's going to be a bestseller. I think it is a bestseller.
Well, you know, I think all these ideas are out there. If somebody's looking to cause mischief, I didn't come up with anything new. I just kind of spun it out to a worst case scenario that we haven't seen yet, you know. But, you know, a few years ago, or last year, I think the Russians were suspected of shutting down the power grid in a Ukraine city for 8 hours, which they did as a show of force. And that was another one of these examples that I just thought, you know, it doesn't shut the power grid down like a bomb would shut it down, but it shuts it down for a few hours. And it's a scary thing, right? It undermines your confidence in the system.
It does. Well, because you also don't know what's next. You know,
right.
So speaking of what's next for you? Do you have another book planned? I mean, what are you doing after this? I think this has been a big success.
Oh, thank you. You know, I am working on another book that has to do with hacking for pharmaceutical companies, which has been kind of an interesting idea to me. You know, and other than that, just kind of working on a nonfiction book about internet governance, actually, as well. A little less scintillating, but still interesting to a group of people.
I love that you've done this. And again, you're number one on the paperback fiction bestseller list, right, at BookSoup?
Oh, For Book Soup, our local boutique store.
Everybody loves Book Soup. Everybody knows Book Soup. That's great. Are you going to be doing any signings? Like, how can we get a hold of you? I mean, what's your website? How can people find you?
It's lynnlipinski.me, and that's information about the book and kind of what's going on with me is up there. Thanks for letting me plug it.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, will you keep us updated? And if anything is going on, will you get back on the show and just tell us what's going on? Just keep track of it?
Oh, I'd love to, Deborah. That'd
okay.
be great.
All right, thanks. Lynn Lipinski, thanks for being here. Author of God of Internet. Thanks for being here. God, I have to tell you, that's kind of scary to me. When I heard about this, now she's an author and she was sort of presuming what could happen, mm-hmm. but there's so much going on out there. I mean, I don't know, the baby monitor, the fact that you can actually lift up your computer and even if the camera's not on, they really can. They can turn it on and look at you. I mean, would anybody really want to do that? But I guess that's what people are doing. My life's not that interesting. You can look all you want, but,
they are. People are watching you, Deborah.
Yeah. Anyway, let's talk about you right now. Your life to me is fascinating. You're from New Jersey.
That's right.
You came out here and you've been a successful actor. Tell us about some of the work that you've done. You're Emmy nominated. I mean, you've done a lot. You've done daytime. You've done prime time. Mm-hmm. And now you have a very successful business. You are a personal trainer to many celebrity people as well. We'll get into that. Mm-hmm. But what was your journey into getting there?
Well, I didn't think I'd be here, not this way. Mm-hmm. My decision to be an actor was a long time ago, and
from back in Jersey.
Back in Jersey, yeah. I wasn't a child performer. I didn't really start any of this until I was in my early 20s, maybe 20, 21, and. I, you know, basically just started trying to work and trying to understand the business and acting and taking classes and running around the city in Manhattan.
This city. Oh, Manhattan. You were in Manhattan at the time. New York City. Okay.
In New York City at the time. And I was lucky. You know, I had gotten a few breaks and a couple good jobs along the way. And from there, I, of course, wanted to continue to keep doing this. So Los Angeles was sort of...
The natural progression.
Exactly. I mean, it was calling me psychically. I think even as a child, I would always dream about being in L.A. I didn't know why.
Well, isn't that true? I mean, come on. You know, back in Jersey, even today, I mean, people just think of, you know, L.A. as the place that, you know, stars are born. And, you know, that's where people just naturally want to flock to.
Yeah. And I think that's exactly it. It does have a sort of allure to it. And I think people, you know, your imagination is much more fertile and crazy than the real realities of things. But at the same time, I tell people all the time, I have a moment, maybe a flash or a minute every day where I feel like I'm getting away with something.
You were telling me that yesterday.
Yeah.
With the good weather especially.
Yeah, and you just, you know, the level of appreciation for just the simple things. You know, it's hard to try to stay connected to the nuance of a beautiful day. You know.
I also think, especially here, where coming here to be an actor, coming here to be anything, you sort of put lots of balls up in the air, and you're always sort of trying to see what one is going to stick. And I think that's tough, and you have to have a really tough composition to be able to withstand that year after year. That could be very, very difficult for so many people, many. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know, it can make you or break you, you know, you learn, and mm-hmm. if you're a aware person and you want to grow, you see that you're tested all the time, you know, just your patience sometimes.
It's hard to do that as an actor, though, because you never know from day to day what your day is going to be. And, of course, if you wake up with a good attitude, you know, you just go for it, whatever happens. But that even that's hard to do because you believe in yourself and what's going on. But
yes,
it's sort of
true.
Up to whatever.
So many other things. I mean, you only have a say in what you're doing by your choice to sort of stay on it. But I tell people all the time, you know, in order to do your acting, you know, you need the cooperation of many people to do this. Mm-hmm. And you get to do very little of it. you know, I remember making the decision to, instead of chasing some regional theater and working on big parts, that I wanted to work as an actor. And I knew that the little bit that I would get to do would be interesting enough for me.
Whenever you did something, whether it was on a guiding light or As the World Turns, ER, you've been on ER.
Mm-hmm.
Did you hope that it would just last and last? You know, when you did that one time or two times or three times, did you think, oh, I want them to call me back? Or do you just accept it, you know?
Well, in terms of accepting it, I mean, you know, that comes with some maturity and time. I mean, I remember, you know, getting my first job and thinking that this would be great and this would go on forever. And it doesn't, you know, you're pushed out of the nest sometimes.
Weren't you on the first episode of ER?
Yes, I did the episode called Day One.
Do we have any of that by chance or no? A shot of that or no?
I played a drunk driver, killed the whole family. It was terrible.
Oh, that's awful. We don't have that, do we?
No, but a lot of people saw that, though. That was a
good. Does that, like, play often? I mean, are you getting, like, residual checks from that? I mean, ER, that's a big deal.
Yeah, but that was I don't even want to say when that was.
That's
okay.
ER has been around forever. I mean, it's
in the mid-90s. I just say that.
Okay, but everybody knows ER. They know it today. They know it then.
Yes.
So, okay, so that's a really big deal.
Yeah.
But
prior to that, I had done a small part on a little series called The Adventures of Briscoe County, Jr.
And what did you do on that?
That was a Western, and I played the sidekick to the lead mm-hmm. in this show. Bruce Campbell. He's in all those Evil Dead movies and...
Yeah, I know.
Yeah. And from there, I got the ER job. That's how they were. It was same.
Was it the same casting? Was it the same?
Yeah,
because
it.
I
exactly.
often wonder, you it know, exactly your picture sitting there in the pile and they go, you know what? He'd be good over here.
Yeah.
So then how long were you on that?
They only did one season. That was an example of hoping something would be picked up, and you know. But as you go through the machinery of this business, you see that it doesn't. You don't invest. You learn to invest better.
But that's how you get through it, by learning to invest better, as opposed to investing all of yourself in it. I think that's where people get into a lot of trouble here. I do.
I agree. It's tricky. It's tricky because they're, you know. There are no rules, and yet there's rules. But at the same time, that's like life. And you're always dealing with one's insecurity and uncertainty. And it's not just being an actor. I mean, that can be a little bit magnified because it does seem to be a big part of that process. But I see that with everybody. I mean, and which obviously has sort of brought me to this point in my life. And the training and the things that I do with my clients are based around, you know, a lot of those types of things. Insecurity, not quite sure, you know. When I bring people up to present time, you know, you've never been here before. Mm-hmm. You've never been this age at this time with this attitude feeling this way.
Mm-hmm.
So from here, and this is the hook that sort of pulled me through.
Pulled you through what? The acting?
No. Back to sort of the fitness, but basically sort of how I was able to get through it. Because my story was I had joined every gym like everybody else, and I paid and never went. And I would go and sort of have the good attitude for a while, and things would sort of peter out. And I always maintained somewhat of a yoga practice. I kept that going. My mother and my sister are both yoga teachers.
Out here or back in Jersey?
Back in Jersey. So I have always sort of kind of kept my toe in it, but I was in my late 30s, and I wasn't in good shape, but I wasn't in bad shape.
What do you mean you weren't in good shape? You're in great shape now. So
well, now
saying,
I am in great
you
shape.
You were heavy, or you just weren't working out? Or?
No, I wasn't. I've never been particularly heavy, but I felt that I was never in necessarily, I shouldn't say great health, but I just wasn't particularly taking care of myself, and I wasn't really paying attention to it. So I started with the gym, and the same thing happened, you know, about 6 weeks into it. I wasn't feeling any better. I wasn't getting any bigger. Those changes weren't happening. And I, of course, wanted to throw in the towel and just sort of give it up. But that's when, which leads me to this point, which is when I realized that I needed to go to a place that I had never been before.
With your fitness, you mean?
Yeah, when with my attitude and my whole idea of maybe just stop waiting to look better or that, just keep up. I tell people all the time, the routine is more important than the workout.
My husband always says to the kids, just show up every day.
That's
just it. Show up. And it may not be a great day, and it may not be a great month or even a year, but if you just show up, eventually something will happen. Hopefully you won't get fired, but just show up and do the best you can. So that's what you did. I mean, so what? You went to the gym, you were on the treadmill.
I just sort of kind of kept working out. And then enough time had passed, maybe 4 or 5 months, and I kind of picked my head up, and I was surprised that how good I felt, how I looked, my body. I was just more empowered than I think I'd ever been in my life. And I was only getting older. So when you're talking about, you know, things in your 20s, and I mean, I was almost out of my 30s when I got into this, that I was more empowered then than I was when I was younger. And that was a big hook for me. And from that point on, I never looked back. I stopped worrying about nonsense and just kept it up. And from that, it's,
and then what? The acting sort of waned? I mean, you had a substantial career going.
Yes. And I continued to sort of chase acting jobs, and, you know, I get a few things here and there, but it was, you know, again, you required so much from so many just to do your thing. So I sort of get you right into my business and how it started.
But basically, didn't you just give up everything? You gave up the manager, the agent,
yes,
everybody. You just cut it off, right?
Yes. And I did that in one moment. You know, they say, you know, making a decision to decide.
Okay, what was that moment? Because that's hard. A lot of people would say, oh, maybe I'll just keep the manager. You never know. So what was the moment?
Well, the moment was that I had to decide what path I wanted to go. And I remember hearing somebody say to, now some people may not like this, but it made sense to me at the time, which was to give up your dreams, not give them up, but just forget about your dreams and follow your effort. And I realized that my effort, and which is what I'm doing. So I was pursuing the things that I liked. So then one thing led to another. I posted some pictures, and somebody said, wow, who was your trainer? And I said, and it was at that moment. But it didn't, that took me a long time to get
that
there.
That must have felt pretty good, though. Who's your trainer? You're like, you're looking at him.
Well, that's about exactly how it happened. And then from that point, some people asked me to train them, and I sort of was a little reluctant. I really wasn't looking to be a trainer. Then a short time later, I literally just woke up one morning and this voice in the back of my head said, just do it. And I never looked back.
Who was your first client? I love this.
Oh, my first client. It's kind of interesting.
Eileen?
Yes. Her name is Eileen Ryan, and she is a actress, and she's older, but she has, this is Sean Penn, the actor Sean Penn, his mom.
Everybody knows Sean Penn. So all you have to do is say that. It's like, oh, wow, cool.
There you go. That's, yeah.
Now, how did you get that? Were you working out at the gym with her? Or?
No, I had a friend who was training her, and he was going out of town. And I had met her, and she'd asked if I would do it while he was out of town. And at that point, I really wasn't training. And I said, yes, I would. And then when he came back, we kind of kept it going. And then quickly thereafter, my girlfriend encouraged me, and, you know, and I just kind of kept moving in that direction and gave up. So it wasn't about letting go of my representation or those kinds of things. It was more about just moving towards what was interesting to me. So I didn't really think about what I was leaving behind. I was really just creating what I wanted to move towards. And that was very easy for me. I didn't feel a lot of stress. And that helped me start to get some momentum and sort of kind of build my business and you know, I mean, then the sort of rest is history. I mean, now this is what I do, you know, and I'm a 24/7 and, you know, and I have a, you know, pretty unique style. There's a lot of great trainers out there.
What is your style? Because you're right. There's so many trainers. I've worked out with a couple of them and my issue has always been the commitment. If I said I'll be there at 10, something would inevitably happen. Let's say you have an audition or something and then you can't show up at 10. And that's very hard when you're trying to keep, you know, keep something going with a trainer. So how do you deal with clients like that? Because I know you have some pretty well-known actress clients. Who are they? Do you mind if I ask?
Well, I, you know, these are people that I've certainly have trained over a period of time. But let me just address your first question. The idea of committing to something. I mean, it is a question of what is important to you. And when you schedule things and you make them the priorities in your life. But the success I've had in my business is probably because of my, and I'll say this and people take advantage, but my flexibility. And we understand that life happens and you have to be able to kind of keep your world moving. And, you know, no one's going to tell you you're picking up your kid is less important than going to the gym. I mean, it is what it is. But you'd be surprised at the way things work out if you want them to work out.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not that difficult. The problem is there's just too much, which is really kind of the hook of my business, is helping people sort out their desktop. I can't solve your problems, but I can help you get into a position to where you can solve your problems. And you know how to sort this out.
So it's a little bit of psychology and training at the same time?
Well,
that's pretty good.
The psychology is just, you know, Deb, when we talked earlier about, you know, the difference. I mean, you could really get into the nuances between men and women and younger people and older people. But it really comes down to things like the human condition. And that's really sort of where I come from with my clients is that you know, there's some basic, simple things, sleep, food, you know, and managing your stress. I mean, those are huge, huge things.
Nothing better than the sleep, of course, but the exercise. I mean, I really believe that. And we also talked about you can get people can just get off their medicines for the most part, unless they're really sick, of course. But the high blood pressure stuff, so many medicines, you can control it at least if, you know, with the food, with all that, the sleep, but clearly with the exercise, helping to control the stress. Everybody knows that. But are people really doing it? And are they doing it right? Like, I like what you talk about with commitment. You need to make the commitment. You need to decide. The way you did, you decided to make the commitment. You might say, oh, I have to train her. I want to do something. But are you committed to it? That's so important.
Well, what you see is that the exercise and the training with the trainer is, you know, is such a small part of the whole process. And it's really about you learning to manage you. It's the same 24 hours for everybody. And if you think you've got a hard story, ask a couple of your friends and they'll tell you about their hard story.
Everybody has one. Even no matter how great they look, they
That's
just
right.
have something.
Sure.
And if they don't have one necessarily, maybe they're managing it better. So you're right. It's all the way what you put into it.
Right. But when I say their story too, is like you understand that there's a lot of undermining things that go on. And the trick is to try to set yourself up in a way that supports this. So if you have, for example, good food in the refrigerator, you're going to tend to grab the good food in the refrigerator. If you've got the cookies, if you've got things that aren't helping you, then, you know, you make those efforts to customize your world. And I tell, you know, most of my clients, if not all of them, have kids and they're on varying ages and having to deal with different menus and different, you know, just trying to pander to try to keep their world moving.
My kids all like something different. I have one who's not the best eater and two who are terrific eaters. I mean, they'll just go and grab some green beans. I mean, you know, who does that? But
well, don't give up on the one who's not such a great eater.
I'm not even a little bit. But it is complicated. Sometimes I'll bake stuff and my girlfriends will walk in and they'll say, what do you have this on the counter for? I said, because they wanted some pound cake. I mean, what am I going to do? I have no pound cake and make it like perfectly good for them with the gluten-free everything. I mean, sometimes you just got to make a pound cake. But in moderation, right?
Of course. You know, I mean, people talk about their diets all the time. And, you know, your diet is just what you're eating. So whether it's a paleo diet or a Mediterranean diet, it's just what you put in your body. That's the diet. And we all know good food, good body. You know, it's like computer, you know.
But I really do believe what you're saying is it's up here. I mean, you really do have to commit up here to do all that, because then the rest does follow. What kind of success do you have with people who are sort of half in and half out when you start with them? Because, like, how many clients do you have, for example? And are they all on the same page with you? Or do
no.
you sometimes have to get them on the same page? Like, let's say I were to work out with you. I'm half in and I'm half out. I'm a little bit lazy. Mm-hmm. I like to work out with my friends. If they can't go, I'll be a little lazy and I won't go. I mean, come on, that's half commitment. Let's mm-hmm. face it. I shouldn't have any excuse. It's like, okay, if you can't go, I'm showing up anyway. Right. What do you do with somebody like that?
Well, you know, we would go around and around and around until we're both exhausted and decide not to do this anymore. That's one way.
Okay. There's a plan. Well, no, it's fair. There's a plan. Or you commit to it.
Or, you know, that's exactly it. I mean, you know, the commitment, you know, that can get a little heavy for people sometimes, you know, and there are a lot of classes out there that give you varying options and things like that. But I usually only train people for a period of time. I try not to go too long with them. I want them to be able to
do it on their own.
Well, not so much do it on their own, but get into their own life. Start to find the things that you like and the things that make sense to you. So that is the ultimate job. So you're connecting with bike riding in the summertime.
Right.
Or walking. I'm a big proponent of walking. They say the answer to every problem is in a long walk.
And I always tell my kids that if it's been a bad day, a walk, a glass of water, and grab a banana on the way out. I don't know why, but for whatever reason, it's a banana, glass of water, and a good
long
walk.
Did you get that from your mother, Deborah?
No, I swear this was on me. Something about bananas, they're okay. I don't even eat them that much. But I don't know. I just felt like it'll keep you full. It's got some potassium in it. The water, you can't go wrong with that. And a walk, just go walk it off. So there's my mantra, if you want to know.
That's good. I mean, those are all great things. And managing, you know, young people don't really have the issue in the sense that they're not so aware of all the things that what this whole thing is really about, the bigger picture of your life. I mean, time does roll on and it goes by quick. And if you're not paying attention, you do pick your head up with an extra 20, 30, 40, 50 pounds and in poor health and tired and feeling terrible. And, you know, and your life's not working. So taking care of yourself, number one priority. From there, all things come and work on feeling better. That's really what I try to get my clients to do. Connect with feeling good. If you feel good, you'll tend to do good.
How many clients do you have currently?
You asked me that. 15.
How often do you see them?
For the most part, 2-3 times a week. Mm-hmm. I have a couple clients that I maintain, I see once a week. Mm-hmm. And they maintain, you know, they do.
Well, look at you. We've got some pictures of you. It looks like a group class.
Maybe yeah, that's exactly what that is. Yeah, that's, I, you know, incorporate a lot of yoga. You know, it just depends on what my client needs. I mean, all my workouts are custom based. Not everybody can do all the same things. That's the actress Sarah Brown, you asked me who. And there, she was on, that's a, in a Days of Our Lives coffee table book, I think.
Oh, really? Okay. Sarah Brown, you also, Michelle Stafford?
Yes.
Who else have you worked out that people would know? That's a pretty big deal.
Joanna Cassidy. She's on Odd Man Out. Odd Mom Out.
She's terrific.
Yes.
She is so great. She looks terrific.
I can't take all that credit.
She must be very committed. You could just see it. I mean, you know, that comes with a lot of hard work.
Yeah. And she's a, you know, dynamic woman. And, you know, we trained for a short time. But she, I was a huge fan and I knew exactly, you know, who she was. And
very cool.
It's been that part, you know, I mean, a lot of that comes with being in Hollywood and whatnot. But it really is, I train a whole host of other people for all varying different things, you know, and that is the sort of the crux of the whole deal. So my programs are case specific, but essentially all based on the same theme, which is better health is easier than you think. And when you get people thinking and starting to pay attention and being present, they find that it's not that complicated. We tend to complicate it. I try to...
Tend to complicate everything.
Everything. And I really do try to bring things down to the base level. Real simple, easy things to understand. Now, people will take that and want to fight it and try different, you know. But at the end of the day, there's sort of irrefutable things like water and good food and everything I mentioned before, rest and exercise and managing your stress. I mean, that's across the board, and that's for everybody, including Kurt, who looks very relaxed.
What else do you do? What do you do in your free time? What do you like to do?
I eat bad food?
I mean, what do you do, like, on a Friday night watching a movie at home? Are you sitting there eating a pile of pizza? Do you ever cheat?
Yeah. I don't believe in cheating in the sense that eat whatever you want, whenever you want.
Yeah, I mean, just a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you want to get into some kind of silly negotiation with yourself. I mean,
I like In-N-Out Burger, okay? I have a hard time passing it by. Oh, okay, sorry. But I do. It's shitty, I guess.
I don't have a problem with that. I would prefer other places. That's all.
Other burgers? I know, but that's like one of my downfalls. Now, I do not do it daily, and I don't even do it weekly, but sometimes when I drive by there, I just have to have one. And I don't even eat. You too?
Oh, yeah.
See?
Oh, yeah. The fries?
Oh, see, I don't even do the fries. I just like the meat and the pickles. That's my thing. The meat, the pickles, and the lettuce. So it's kind of like protein style.
Yeah, that's great.
I could do like a better burger, but that's sort of my vice. At least it's not, you know, McDonald's. Sorry, McDonald's, but still.
Right.
You know, we all have one. Do you have a vice? Like, come on, something that you probably shouldn't eat and you do?
Well, I mean, honestly, I'm a pretty skinny guy.
Yeah,
I spin, you know, 5-6 times a week.
You spin?
I used to spin.
I was spinning again with a friend, and she would drag me, and I got so hooked on it. And I lost a lot of weight doing spinning. That'll do it.
Well, yeah, it would. And, you know, there's a lot of different styles of spinning out there. You know, a lot of these big marquee clubs, spin so high for so long that, you know, it does keep a large section of the population away from it. I'm much more accessible when I'm doing this. I don't want my clients or the people in any kind of a group class to leave completely blown out. People think that that's a good thing. I think you've got other things to do today. So to leave everything in the gym is kind of silly.
That's kind of a great idea, but I'll tell you.
Unless you're training for something.
Yeah, I don't leave blown out. I tend to like to sit in the back. I pray that they don't bother me. Mm-hmm. Half the time I don't even go up because of my knees. Mm-hmm. You know, when they tell you, don't come up now. Mm-hmm. I just do my thing, and I'm sort of riding at my own pace, and half the time I'm not even listening to them. But I get in a great workout, so I do my thing.
Well, I would suggest that to people all the time. You
really?
Know? But the bike, just the dynamics of the bike, your hips, knees, and ankles in line and working, you know, most people's lower bodies are pretty underdeveloped, you know, and just don't have the leg endurance to hold yourself up.
Yeah.
So, you know, though there's so many pluses to it that, you know, I tell people all the time, you know, ride your own ride. I mean,
easy. Where do you spin here in town?
I spin at a couple different places, all for LA Fitness.
So you go to LA Fitness?
Yeah. Great club, you know. Good group of people, and I like
they're everywhere too.
Yeah, and I like the you know, the group dynamic. There's not, you know, I don't train that way. I'm better one-to-one with my clients, and you know, a lot of personal trainers like it that way.
What are you most proud of with your work and just in life in general?
I would say proud. I don't know if proud is the word, but you know,
fulfilled.
I appreciate the fact that I have something that I'm way into, and I do love this, and I'm really, you know, passionate about it, and I work all the time, and I enjoy it. And I've had many jobs where it's a real grind just to get up in the morning. And this affords me, you know, a much more dynamic life, you know, and that I appreciate. And I, you know, and I try to encourage people to find that for themselves too.
Do you ever want to take it to a different level, another level, where as you're going around and you're talking to people about it, giving speeches about it, trying to motivate them, because you're very motivating and you're motivating one-on-one, but I wonder, are you one of those guys who would ever want to be motivating on a larger scale, if you will, and reach even more people?
The answer to that is yes, Deborah.
So what are you doing and what will you be doing?
So yeah.
People can find you.
Yeah, well, they can find me at jefffillipsfitness.com. I'm always looking, you know, the basic principle is you're looking for the people that are looking for you. Mm-hmm. And the more my message gets out, obviously the better off. I think everybody should be training with me. But at the same time, you know, everybody, you know, not everybody's looking for the same thing. I mean, the advertising is either morbidly obese or let's get down to, you know, 8%, 5% body fat. And most people can't do that. And most people aren't interested in that.
God, that's hard. I mean, my body fat tends to be higher than it should be.
Well,
but,
because you go for the health. So I would, for example, if I were to start with a client, I call it the State of the Union. We get a baseline. Where are you and what is up? And then from there, we'll assess and design a program that you can stick to for a period of time. And then you reassess and you just keep moving in that direction.
That brings me to you. We were talking yesterday on the phone. You were telling me about getting involved with a reality show. Tell me about that.
Well, I can't talk too much about it, but yeah. I will just tell you that I am developing a reality show based on that very premise, State of the Union. In a period of time, people being able to change their lives for the long term. So the antithesis to that would be, for example, like a Biggest Loser, where they can lose that massive amount of weight.
Way too fast.
Way too fast and not quite have the skills enough to keep it going.
To sustain it. That's really tough.
I think they've been handed the answers to the quiz, but that's a whole different bargain when you're actually doing that work. So when I have a few, you know, heavier clients, that it is a slower process. And if you knew just a tiny little bit about the human body and how we tend to, the body will hold on to certain things, and it does take a while. But once you start to turn the corner and you feed the body with the nutrition that it needs, it does what it needs to do. The body always wants to heal itself.
So I like that. So a reality show based on how many people would you have on the show?
Well, it would always be on a case-by-case basis. So we would just follow someone's journey, maybe two, three people, their journey over a period of time. And then sort of measure the change. All the change is measurable, so you'd be able to see. But what you're really looking for is somebody's journey from A to B or to C or D, and that can they make this transition and reconnect with themselves? And this is your life, and it's only this time, and we're only here for a little while. All those kinds of things really start to come into play. So when people are looking to be motivated, I encourage them to motivate themselves. Find things to inspire yourself.
That's always the hardest. And I like what you said. Find something to inspire yourself. Something. And not a someone, really.
No, that's always that's a poor investment. Because
it's a very poor investment.
Your everything is depending on somebody else. I talk about 100% personal responsibility, which is can be totally overwhelming for a lot of people.
I agree with you because I've been there. I've been down this road with workout stuff.
But hear me on this. Once you accept that, you then have total freedom. And when you are aware of the things that you do and the things that you're, you know, putting into your body you're either helping or you're hurting. And, you know, you're working in that process. But I wanted to touch one thing before we get past it. When we were talking about food and your... I guess it was your son who's not necessarily a big eater. Or he's very particular.
He's my in-and-out guy.
Okay. Well, I wasn't quite an in-and-out guy, but I was definitely not a guy who ate well when I was younger. I mean, we grew up kind of latchkey kids a little bit, you know. And I would have these standoffs with my mother about the vegetables. And I would sit there, and she'd sit there, and I could not get up for hours. And at the end of the day, I tell people all the time, I won. And, you know, it was one of those fights you wish you didn't win.
Yeah, but now look at you. As you got older, you realized the benefits.
Exactly, of course. And but I also had to create things to be able to do this. So things like juicing. And I like raw vegetables. And I'll eat salads. And if the things I don't like, I will put in my Nutribullet, plug for Nutribullet here. Those kinds of things to get the nutrients in.
The Nutribullet is where you make your own juices and stuff.
Yes.
Right? Yeah. That thing is terrific.
Yeah, it is terrific.
It's absolutely fantastic. You can really sweeten it up, too.
Sure.
So for people who don't want the color green or who are afraid it's going to be a little sour, there's so much that you can put in there. Because what's sweet? Like the apple makes things sweeter,
sure.
Right?
Apple,
the carrots.
Or pear.
Pear, right. Yeah. I mean, apples and pears always make things. And bananas, back to my bananas.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
They make it a little more sustainable, a little more hearty. Wouldn't you say a banana? I love bananas.
Yeah, bananas are good. And I use like a coconut water or something. But obviously you see that you have to figure this out. So when you talk about things like excuses and commitments, it's maybe less about those things, you know, and it's more about what it is that you're trying to do. If you want to feel better or if you want to lose weight or you want to improve your health, you just have to start doing things that take you in that direction. And that is very simple and very easy to follow. It can get complicated as we go down the road as you are confronting you. So that whole you versus you thing is the real deal. And when you...
And you found it. And, you know, I think through your training, you try and help other people find it too.
Yeah,
which
that
is what I'm getting from you. So that's really what makes you so unique. There's a lot of trainers out there. But are they really getting inside to what the person really needs to make that change? Because it is hard. That's why so many people, that's why they fall back a lot. They have to sort of find what's inside. Anything else you want to add? Because we're out of time.
No. I mean, you know.
So what else do you do for fun? You didn't really tell me that.
I mean,
do you skydive? I mean, what do you do?
That's
crazy. You have?
I have.
I knew it. I could tell you were a skydiver. I don't know. I just picked that out of there. I'm like, okay, so what else do you
do? I used to be a big skier. When I was younger.
Where did you ski?
Oh, I skied everywhere, up and down the East Coast. My brother was a big skier. So that was sort of my winter activity. And then I would spend the sort of summers working so I could be skiing. Now I, you know, I in my work, I may do some rock wall climbing or some tough mudders or, you know, hikes and things like that in my sort of business world. But it's really my lifestyle.
It's your lifestyle.
There's not.
And that's why you love being out here, because it allows you to do it. Of attitude about almost anything. I mean, I could turn, you know, lemon into lemonade pretty much. I might be sour for a day or two, but it always ends up at lemonade no matter what. So it is. It does come down to your attitude.
Well, it goes a long way.
No, it does. It really does. So, but you know, sometimes you have to work on that too. So anyway, it was great having you here. I really appreciate it. Fascinating
thank you for
guy.
Me.
Yeah. Thank you. Jeff Phillips. Jeff Phillips Fitness, jefffillipsfitness.com.
That's right. That's
okay.
My website.
We can find you very easily.
Yeah, and you can find me on Twitter and Instagram.
And on Twitter. And Facebook. Yeah, and if they want to get a hold of you, if anybody wants to do some training,
you can
go to the website.
Yep, you can reach out to me through my website or my Facebook. I get somebody taking care of that, but somehow it'll get to me.
Maybe after this, I'll have you do an evaluation of me, and we'll see what happens, and then we'll come back.
Perfect. How's that for an evaluation?
I agree. So we'll do it another time, though. All right. Thanks for being here,
thanks
for being here for a fun edition of Kobylt and Friends, and we'll see you next week.